Let me invite you to take your Bibles and turn with me to Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 19. Ephesians chapter 3. Then consider the word of the Lord with me. Your version may be a little bit different than mine, but might we consider what it says and how it ministers to our hearts as I read it this morning. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14. For this reason I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Lord, I pray in these moments as we open this passage of Scripture, as I share that burden upon my heart and my spirit, trust, Lord, that you, O Holy Spirit, have done the work in your people here today that would connect and grasp with these words. And we'll thank you together as we ask it, Jesus, in your name, amen. Leave these dwellings. One of the things I want you to see in Ephesians chapter 3 and those verses that we read, that Jesus wants to dwell in our hearts. He wants to dwell there. Early in our ministry in the Punxsutawney Alliance Church, we were actually, you know, kind of living in three places, which was a lot of fun. We had purchased a home and were, you know, getting prepared to move in there. We still had stuff in Watsontown, as many of you know who came to help us move. We had to do that twice. Took the opportunity to be living at Mahaffey Camp in the Owens Cottage, which my grandchildren found absolutely fascinating. But there came a point where you can't live in three places at one time. And so there is this sense where if we're going to allow Jesus Christ to dwell in our hearts, then we have to, in some manner and way, remove other things that are dwelling there. You with me? That basic concept is one of the things that I want in my heart and my prayers to drive this sermon. We will never know the fullness of these verses. We will never know what it's like to know the fullness of God if we won't quit dwelling in the three things that are on your outline. I want to take a look at them. First of all, you and I have got to quit dwelling on what we were. And instead focus on what we are becoming. Now, I realize within any group of people, there may be those senses where you say, hey, buddy, you don't know what I've done. And I don't. It's very interesting that my brother and sister and some of my friends have a different version of my childhood than I do. And it's always interesting to sit around and share some of those stories. But it's not about what you were. It is about what you are becoming. And too many times we dwell on past failure. Too many times we dwell on areas of our life that weren't right, that weren't connected, that in somehow we had walked away from God, and that then defines where we're at. We're stuck there. God can never forgive me. God can't forgive me. You don't know what I've done. If you knew this about me, you wouldn't like me. Look, somewhere along the line, if we want to know the fullness of what God has for us, we have to quit dwelling in that place. We have to quit letting that dwelling of what we were define us and control us. Instead, look at what you are becoming, what Jesus Christ is doing. If you're here today and you have accepted and received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're a believer, a follower of Jesus, a disciple, if you're His, then what has happened in the past is covered by the blood. It's forgiven. Amen. Forgiven. I'm going to mention that one more time because I only got like one amen. You're forgiven. Do you know what it means to be forgiven? Oh yeah, forgiven means that I keep bringing it up to myself. Oh, forgiven is, and you know, Satan will do that all the time. Oh yeah, you want to do that? Yeah, just think about that last time. Or think about this, and if they ever found this out, okay, I get it. Many of us were wrecks. But all of a sudden, Jesus Christ came and did something. He made me a new creation. I often think what I would have been if God would not have led me to York College of Pennsylvania, if God would not have let me meet Craig Fox, if I wouldn't have given my heart to the Lord there in Third South Dormitory, room 354, where I gave my heart. I often wonder where I've been. Man, you can spend a lot of time with ifs, can't you? If I'd have just done this, if I could have, would have, should have. But what about what you are? And what He wants to make you, and what you are becoming. And I want to talk about two characters in Scripture. And the first character I want you to look at is Martha. And if you would go back with me to Luke chapter 10. Gospel of Luke in chapter 10. And in that 10th verse, in that 10th chapter, I want you to look at verses 38 and 39. Now it happened as they went that he entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me." Jesus' response, of course, was not, there, Martha, I'm going to tell Mary, go help you. What was his response? Go ahead, tell me, I know. Says, look, she's picked the better part. How many of you have ever felt like 2 cents? How many of you have ever taken the opportunity to take foot A and put it in mouth B and wash your toes? Anybody? Anybody? Okay, anybody besides me. Yeah, I mean, there are times in which, yeah, there's only one way to say it. There are just times, Do you think that's one of these times for Martha? How would you have felt if in this gathering of people, Jesus said, you are much encumbered and worried about serving. Mary has chosen the better part. Tell me. Well, okay, you don't have to tell me. Think in your brain. I don't have telepathy. I won't know anyway. How would you have felt? So Martha is one of those people who could take the opportunity to say with resounding effectiveness, oh, I have failed. I have failed. I'm so worried about this. I'm so worried about I failed. But you know, that's not the end of the story. Let me have you turn over to John chapter 11. In John chapter 11, I want you to listen to these verses. John chapter 11. Then Martha, as soon as she had heard that Jesus was coming, that's verse 20, went and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you'd have been here, my brother would not have died. Listen to this. Even now, parenthesis, even now, even though my brother has been dead for 4 days, even though he is laid in that grave and he has started to decompose, even though my brother, dead for 4 days, who now surely stinks, who is bereft of any life, we've lost all our social status, all our income, Jesus, even now, I know whatever you ask God, God will give you. Does this sound like the lady who was working herself to a frazzle? Or has Martha now become someone different than that lady? Now, that doesn't mean that Martha is going to be different. Martha is still going to worry about whether we have enough mashed potatoes and gravy. Martha is still going to take the opportunity to get perplexed at times at how to feed so many people, how to make it all work. She's going to want to make sure that things are dusted and things are clean and everything is right and the table is set. That will not change. But something did change. If you go on a little bit further, it says this. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? I am no longer worried about what I was, Jesus. I'm worried about those encumbering things, doing those things. But right now, I look at you eyeball to eyeball in my grief, knowing that anything you ask of God, you'll receive because you're the Son of God. And he says, do you believe this? And what did she say? Yes, Lord, I believe. She was now taking the opportunity to find out what she is becoming because what was past is past. Can you live that? If you would look in Mark chapter 5, Mark chapter 5. In Mark chapter 5, we are introduced to the demoniac of Gadara. There's all sorts of ways to say that, the Gadara, the Gadarenes, Gergesenes, all those words you'll find. But what we do is find a unique individual. And this unique individual, of course, you know the account as well as I do. He was possessed by demons. This is not the guy you would invite to your next party. He spent his time cutting himself, spent his time running around the tombs. They've tried to restrain him and he's broke those restraints. He is something of a character. You know the account as well as I. You've read it. Jesus comes to him. Jesus casts the legion out of him. But please don't miss the rest of the story. I sound like, you know, Paul Harvey now. Of course, I am reminded that not all of you know who Paul Harvey is. Some of you didn't even remember Sesame Street. So look at this. In Mark chapter 5, it says these incredible things about this demoniac. It says that he is clothed and in his right mind. Verse 18, and when he got into the boat, he who had been demon-possessed begged him that he might be with him. However, Jesus did not permit him, but said to him, go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he has had compassion on him. Verse 20, and he departed and began to proclaim in Decapolis, 10-city area, all that Jesus had done for him, and all marveled. was he being a dweller in what was? Or did he become someone who was more interested in what he was becoming? One of the beauties of this story, when Jesus came to this side and cast the demons out, the people sent him away. People sent Jesus away. They didn't want him there. And so Jesus leaves and leaves this man. Do you know what happened when Jesus came back to this side? Multitudes were already there ready because of somebody who would not dwell in what they were, but instead would begin to live out what they were becoming. And you and I will never know the fullness of God. You and I will never know the fullness of what God wants to do in our hearts. We will never allow Jesus truly to dwell in us if we're dwelling someplace else. We need to come from dwelling on what we were to what we are becoming. Something was said in our Sunday school class that if we didn't meet for another year, when we got back together, there was the hope that we would all have learned something new. Are you growing? Are you developing as a Christian believer? What are you becoming? Here's the second thing that you and I need to quit dwelling on or in. I want you to realize with me that if we are going to have Jesus Christ dwell in our heart, if we are going to know the fullness of God's love, then we have to quit dwelling on Christianity as a constant struggle. Here's one that no one will know. Anybody remember the Jetsons? Anybody remember Rosie? Anybody remember when Rosie had her heart broke by Max? Here's this robot, and all she did was go, "Ho, hum, ho, hum." Remember this? I do. I mean, I was only 6. "Ho, hum, ho." Sometimes that's the way I hear Christians. "Ho, hum." This Christian life is such a constant struggle. I'll stop here for a minute, because I do have a caveat. And that is the fact, yeah, as a Christian believer, we do go against the grain. We do go against the current. And there are struggles. Please do not interpret what I am sharing you as an insensitivity to your struggles. What I want you to understand with me is the fact that you and I, if we are going to let God truly dwell in us, if we're going to know and experience His fullness, we got to quit dwelling on the fact that it's such a struggle to do it. That every time we turn around, we are prone to fail and to fall. That every time we keep missing. I want you to know something, that if you saved, set free, with Jesus dwelling in your heart, you have an advantage. A great big advantage. Why? Because the Holy Spirit makes the presence of Jesus real in your life and my life. That's why we can say, "You ask me how I know He lives? He lives within my heart." Look, I realize that there are times that we have difficulties. Please don't hear me naysaying that. Please don't hear me in some manner, in some way, belittling the struggles that you're in. But I want to tell you, somewhere along the line, where in the world have we got to the point that this Christian life was such a struggle, was such a ho-hum? Now, I realize a lot of our hymnology helps us in this. I mean, how many times have we talked about, "For such a worm as I"? Well, you know, that's B.C., people. That's before Christ. And I don't know why He died for such a worm as I, but this worm is glad. I want you to understand that this worm doesn't have to stay a worm. I became, on that moment when I received Jesus Christ, a new creation. I am now a son, a child of the living God. I'm joint heirs with Jesus. That is not to say that you and I don't make mistakes, and that is not to say that you and I do not have our struggles. Please don't hear that. Hear this instead, that you and I are to come to Christ and to live in Him a life that is natural as respiration. How many of you, when you were growing up, not when you were growing up, but how many had children when they were growing up and they would hold their breath when you said something they didn't like? Anybody? Anybody? So you went to talk to your pediatrician about it, and what did he say? Let them. They'll breathe. Okay, maybe you didn't have the same pediatrician we did. My children used to close their eyes. Okay, I would be scolding them, and they would close their eyes. I would then remind them, I am still here. And when those beautiful brown eyes that you got from your mom open again, I'll still be here. Okay? Natural is respiration. Yeah, the kid's going to breathe. In your hymn books, and I want you to take your hymn book in front of you and turn. The founder of the Christian Missionary Alliance, Dr. A.B. Simpson, Albert Benjamin Simpson, wrote a hymn. It's number 251. It's called Breathing Out and Breathing In. Now, I want you to look at it, and this is an Alliance church that's been around a while. How many of you ever remember singing this? Raise your hand. No, raise it higher so I can count them. I'm having a hard time counting this. I want to announce to you that there are two people in the Punxsutawney Alliance today who have sung this song. And that's okay. A lot of the songs A.B. Simpson wrote are very difficult to sing. They were written at a period of time with a martial kind of beat to it that kind of went out of vogue. But don't miss the message of the song. And so I want us to read it. Well, I want us to read it together. A.B. Simpson was also a poet. And so these words are kind of like poetry. So, do you have it with me? Number 251. You say, you actually want me to read this with you? Yeah, because we're not going to get through singing it very well with only two of us, and I only sang it twice. Let's read it together. Jesus, breathe the Spirit on me. Teach me how to breathe Thee in. Help me pour into Thy bosom all my life from self and sin. I am breathing out my own life that I may be filled with Thine. Letting go my strength and weakness, breathing in Thy life divine. Breathing out my sinful nature, Thou hast borne it all for me. Breathing in Thy cleansing fullness, finding all my life in Thee. I am breathing out my sorrow, O Thy kind and gentle breast. Breathing in Thy joy and comfort, breathing in Thy peace and rest. I am breathing out my longings in Thy listening, loving ear. I am breathing in Thy answers, still every doubt and fear. I am breathing every moment, drawing all my life from Thee. Breath by breath I live upon Thee. Blessed Spirit, breathe in me. Isn't that what it's about? That my life in Jesus Christ is like breathing in and breathing out. It becomes as natural as respiration. But we will never experience that fullness if we won't quit dwelling on the fact that ho-hum, it is such a struggle. It is so tough. Oh, it's so bad. Oh, that's never, never going to work to dwell there. But breathing in, breathing out, I understand respiration. I understand breathing. If your kid holds his breath and faints, guess what he's going to do? He's going to breathe. Are you breathing in Jesus, breathing out self? Are you breathing in his word, breathing out what you think, your opinion? Are we breathing in, breathing out? Is our relationship with God so tight and so connected that it's like breathing to love him, to follow him, to do what's right, to walk away from what is wicked and wrong? Does that make sense? The next subpoint that I have there is from trying harder to living fuller and deeper. Here's one in which I have a real problem personally, because so many times I think my sermons sound like, at least from where you're at, I gotta try harder, I gotta do better, I gotta try harder, I gotta do better, I gotta try harder, I gotta do better, I gotta try harder, try harder, try harder. Preacher, try hard, try hard. And you may say, yep, that sounds a lot like you. But somewhere along the line, we have got to get out of trying harder and grasping the power that is ours in Jesus Christ to live it, to operating in the power and the purpose of God fuller and deeper, not just trying harder, but going deeper, not just trying harder, but living fuller. You see, that's what God wants. Because that's what Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 19 say. That's what he wants. He wants the fullness of God in your life. He wants to dwell in your heart. He wants that. But he can't live there if something else is living there. If we are constantly dwelling on the fact, this is so tough. This is such a struggle. This is more than I can bear. And that doesn't mean that you and I don't find ourselves in those places from time to time. But we don't have to stay there. We don't have to stay there. And then this third point that I share with you. We will never know how deeply and fully God wants to minister and live out his life in us when we are dwelling on the difficulty of living for Christ in our culture. You say, well, didn't you just say that? Yeah, I did. But now I'm being real specific. And I'm talking about our culture. Our culture is different than any other culture on the face of the earth. The reason why I'm bringing this out is because where do y'all live? You live in the United States of America, don't you? I thought that was an easy question. Don't put your hand up for any of these questions, but let me just put them out to you. How many of you, not because you decided to, have ever been starving? How many of you have ever taken the opportunity, not of a choice of your own, to have no place to sleep? How many of us, through no fault of our own, have suffered persecution? See, I want to talk about this culture. This would be a different point in my message if I was preaching in Burkina Faso, where Pat and I in August had the opportunity to go to a missions trip, where they tell us that people live on about $1 to $2 a day, where one meal a day is a blessing, not two or three or six. where when you get away from the bigger cities, you come to places that you can't imagine how people are living. So I want to talk about this culture. And if you will take a subpoint to the subpoint, I want to talk to our teenagers. I want to talk to you, because you are living in a culture that is very anti-Christian. You are living in a culture that thinks your relationship with Jesus Christ is crazy. Keep being crazy. Crazy in love with Jesus Christ. Our culture is increasingly more and more anti-God, unless it's somebody else's God. Increasingly more and more hostile to the Bible, more and more hostile to the morality of the Bible, more and more contentious of the fact that there's something wrong with all of us who are believers. They say we need a crutch. We need a crutch. Honey, I don't need a crutch. I need a stretcher, okay? I need somebody to hold me. I need somebody to be there for me, and that's Jesus. It's not a crutch. When do we start claiming his victory in us? Turn with me, if you would, to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And in that fourth chapter, it tells us this, verses 7 through 10. But we have this treasure, oh man, in earthen vessels. That's what we were. Now we're a treasure. That the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested, made real, in our body, in my body, in who else's body? Go like this. Who else's body? Yeah, yours. God's claim is that there is victory for us. God's claim is not to back up and kowtow and bow to the culture. But to proclaim victory. Too many Christians seem to live life defeated, discouraged, disillusioned, and desperate. Why is that? That does not mean that we do not have difficulties. We do. But also, do we know the love of Christ in them, in those circumstances, in those situations? Listen to that Corinthian passage again. Listen to the confidence. Listen to the victory that is expressed under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to the Apostle Paul. Listen to what he says. We are hard pressed on every side, yet we're not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. We are struck down, but not destroyed. I'm just about tempted to read it again. But do you understand what he's saying? He's saying, look, I'm not defeated. I'm not discouraged. I'm not disillusioned, and I'm not desperate. Because my focus is on Jesus. Now, Let me give you a couple quick things. First of all, don't put your focus on me. The neatest person in your life, the person with the most voice into your living, no. Don't put your trust there. Because if you do, then you will be discouraged, then you will be disillusioned, then you will be desperate, then you'll be defeated. In two districts, I had the opportunity to sit on the License Ordination Consecration Council of the Christian Missionary Alliance. I just wanted to get that in there so you'd be impressed. One of the hardest things of serving there is when I had to look at my brothers who were in moral failure. And since I've been around a long time, I know a lot of guys. And over those years, I've had to stand with more of my friends, people who were more than just acquaintances, more than just a name, who've worked through moral failure. If you look at people long enough, you will be disillusioned. You will be discouraged. Hopefully you're not defeated. Maybe desperate for a work of God. And I trust that as you weigh the things that I have said, the burden that is on my heart, you'd realize that there is an alternative to that. You would realize that God wants to do something more and greater and fuller in you than you can ever imagine. But he doesn't and can't and won't, because you can't have too many dwellings. Make sense? And if we're so busy dwelling on what we were, if we are so busy dwelling on Christianity, our faith is a constant struggle. And if we are continually trying to dwell with the difficulty of living in our culture, we're going to miss the dwelling of Jesus. In that Ephesians passage, I want you to look at those concluding verses of our scripture passage for today. That you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width, the length, and depth, and height. To know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. That you may be filled with the fullness of God. The fullness of God can't have the fullness of what you were. Can't have the fullness of what a struggle this is. Can't have the fullness of constantly bowing to the culture in which we live. Somewhere along the line, we're called to become someone in Christ. Somewhere along the line, we are called to live in Jesus and breathe out self. We are to have a relationship with him that is as natural as a relationship with any friend. Natural as respiration. And we are to claim victory. Claim victory. Live in victory as well. So I'm going to ask that you take the opportunity just for a few moments to close your eyes, bow your heads. Make that place where you're sitting right now an altar to God. Don't worry about who's next to you. Don't worry about time you're getting out, because that's going to be soon. Just for this moment, make that place your Ebenezer, your Bethel. place for you to meet God. And I just want to ask you three simple questions. What are you becoming? How is your breathing? And why are you downcast? If you're here today, you say, Pastor, look, there's some things that are dwelling within me and within my heart, take out room for Jesus to dwell there. And it may not be even anything I preached about. Will you right now tell God, I want you, Jesus, to dwell in my heart. I want the fullness of God in me. And if you've said that, just real quick, put up your hand, put it down. Just real quick. That's been your prayer. Thank you. Lord, I pray for our hearts and our spirits that we would take the opportunity to truly understand the fullness of God as something you want desperately for me and for us. Help us, Jesus, I pray. Grasp it, hold it, and make it our own, because we claim it in the name and the person of Jesus Christ. And all the people said, Amen. Amen.